to read to you something out of Revelation about the seventh trumpet, about the Feast of Yom Teruah. It says, Revelation 11:15, it says, "The seventh angel sounded, and there were great voices in heaven saying, 'The kingdoms of this world have become the kingdoms of the Almighty and of his Messiah, and he shall reign forever and ever.'" And then it talks about the first resurrection being that day. "This is now the time that the righteous dead will be judged, and you will reward your servants, the prophets and the saints, and those who fear your name, both small and great. And they shall be priests of Yehovah and his Messiah, and they shall reign with him 1,000 years. So that resurrection is clearly at the beginning of those 1,000 years, which happens at the Feast of Trumpets, when the king comes back and claims this world, and all the kingdoms of this world become the kingdoms of the Almighty. And then in Revelation 12, when we see a parenthetical flashback, basically, that goes back to look at Yom Teruah back in the past, when there was a great sign in heaven, the woman clothed with the sun and the moon, you know, the king's star was seen. And it says that she was almost in labor. So she gave birth to Yeshua the first day of Sukkot, but here at Trumpets 15 days earlier, you see the king's star on the Feast of Trumpets, which the Feast of Trumpets is all about him coming back as king. So it's so appropriate that the wise men saw his kingly star, his king's star, on the Feast of Trumpets back then, and when she was almost going to give birth. So Teruah means to shout, and so the seventh trumpet that sounds to bring in the new kingdom is also the cry of triumph, as the corrected King James Version calls it. So Yom Teruah is full of personal and global hope. The global hope being the return of the good king to take over the governments of the world and make them fall in line with Yehovah's ways, and he's going to rid this planet of evil governments, wicked things going on. Personal hope, it is full of personal hope. Personal hope is the moment when you're transfigured, when you're given the immortal body, and you have the hope that the dreams that you've always dreamed will come true. So no more sickness, no more tears, no more suffering, no more pain, no more growing old, no more wrinkles, no more issues with things that are part of being mortal. He's going to change us in the twinkling of an eye. That is the personal hope of Yom Teruah. There is nothing like this feast. This is full of hope. Okay, you also know in Revelation when it talks about the two witnesses in Jerusalem at the end of the age, when a great fear fell upon all those who saw them, and they heard a great voice from heaven calling to the two witnesses, "Come up here!" And they ascended up into heaven in a white cloud while their enemies watched. Well, this is a reference. Michael Rood in the chronological gospels actually says this is a reference to the scenario that is rehearsed at the beginning of every single month, when the two witnesses are called up to the Temple Mount to report their sighting of the new moon. This is especially important for the sighting that begins the seventh month, as that sighting begins the high Shabbat of Yom Teruah. This is the feast that is known as occurring on a day and hour that no man knows, because it is determined by the sighting of the new moon by two witnesses, and the verification by the Kohen Gadol, who announces, "Blow the trumpet." Every month, this rehearsal was anticipating the last trumpet that will sound the very next event, which is the coming of the king. So one of the things about Yom Teruah that's crucial is that Yom Teruah is to be celebrated on the seventh new moon, seventh month. And the word new moon in the scriptures that have been translated into month is the word Hodesh, and taking Strong's literally, it means new moon. So as far as we understand, is that, and the Hebrew scholars and experts in this field understand and know, is that the word month has been kind of put in after the fact. So the word Hodesh means new moon. So a new moon is one that you sight, one that you can see, one that you can observe. So there's commands in the Torah to observe the month of Aviv, to observe your month. So the only way you can observe is not a dark moon you can't observe. That's duh. So you observe and you watch for that sliver of the new moon of the seventh month. That's a beautiful thing. So we believe very strongly that the calendar is a big deal here, because if you don't show up on the right new moon or the right time of the month, then there's a problem. You're going to miss the feast. So we believe calendar is very crucial. It's not just about just showing up to Trumpets whenever you feel like it. It's about showing up to Trumpets when you're supposed to show up to Trumpets. And the scripture says seventh new moon. So we take it very seriously. Every month, we, from Rosh Hashanah, after the barley's Aviv, that first new moon is Rosh Hashanah, the head of the year. And then we begin looking for that new moon every month. We have a party. Our family goes out for Chinese food every new moon and look up at the sky. Get your head off the ground and look up and teach your children to look in the sky. There's a sand timer in the sky. Easy. Absolutely easy. You don't need a sundial. You don't need anything man-made. You don't need some long calculation. It's so simple. A kid can do this. A shepherd in the field can do this. The illiterate can do this. You look up in the sky and you can see the moon. And if you're familiar with the moon, the more you watch, the more you become familiar, you can tell if that's a sliver or if it's a two-day-old or a three-day-old moon. So Psalms 81 is so cool. It says, sound the ram's horn at the new moon, and, which is saying there's something else, so not the same thing, and at the full moon during the time of your feast. Now, one thing that I just blew me away last week was the fact that the word feast in there is, when I actually started looking at it, it's mishag, it's C-H-A-G, and then A-G or whatever. So it actually, Strong's, it actually means pilgrimage, a pilgrimage feast. So interesting that the study I did on it was actually, I found out that the only time Yehovah uses the word feast or chag to describe one of his feasts is actually at the three pilgrimage feasts. At the other Moedim, they're just Moedim. They're a time when we're supposed to have a holy convocation or gather, assemble. But he actually does not refer to any of the other ones as feast, because that word feast has the innuendo that you're supposed to move. You're supposed to travel for that feast up to Jerusalem for those three feasts. So you have unleavened bread, Shavuot, or Feast of Weeks, and then Sukkot, that you're supposed to travel. He calls those, celebrate the feast to me. It's a pilgrimage feast, right? Okay, so here's the thing. At the full moon, you're supposed to do those feasts. Well, why? Oh, it's a practical reason. For one thing, you need the full moon for light to travel, do you not? So when Isaac and the girls and I lived in a teepee, we became very, very hyper aware of the phases of the moon, because you're out off grid, no electricity. And when the full moon came, oh, it was so nice. You could go outside, you could walk your paths of travel, you could see things, you could make moon shadows, we could walk to the bathroom, we could walk to the tub, we could walk to our chickens, we could walk to the schoolhouse or down to the fridge. So the new moon was a dark time. You don't celebrate Sukkot during a dark time of the month, during a sliver moon. No, you celebrate it during the full moon, and Psalms 81 proves that, which lays to rest any issue with when do I celebrate the feasts. I mean, it's so clear. You look at some words in the scriptures that are very important to understand. He names in the covenant, in the Melchizedek royal law, that's Exodus 19 through 24, you see in there, I think it's in Exodus 23, celebrate this during the month of Aviv. Okay, so the important thing is to figure out, what does Aviv mean? What did Papa mean by Aviv? Figure that out. And I think you will conclude that Nehemiah Gordon, Michael Rood, Keith Johnson, the team over there, They are experts in this. They know what Aviv means. And now they have discovered. So now we know what the month of Aviv is. We know how to find it. And a new moon is a sliver. It's easy. It's not complicated. It's supposed to be easy so that everyone in Israel, from the little kids all the way up to the old ones, educated and non-educated, can find Yahuwah's rhythm and live it so they're watching and not unaware. It's really simple, people. So the seventh new moon is watching for that seventh new moon. Now in the end, we won't be watching for the moon at all. We're just practicing on the moon right now. We're going to, in the end, on that Yom Teruah, when he's ripping through the clouds, we're going to be watching for him. So a couple activities we did last night was one was called Rafah. So there's a practice among Judaism and the Messianic crowd that practices something on Yom Teruah that's called Tashlit. And Tashlit is basically you take this, your sin, and you put it on a piece of bread and you toss it into the water, and supposedly the water magically just takes it away. Well, this isn't scriptural, because the scripture says that Yahuwah himself will take away our sin and make us white as snow. So the idea is that Rafah is actually a better practice, because Rafah, the Hebrew word Rafah, means to let go, be still, relax. So at the beginning of the fall feast season, we practice Rafah, to let go and to be still, to focus, to relax. So we spend some time thinking about what is the things right now that control us, our minds, what are the situations, the impossible situations that are in front of us right now, the things we're facing, the things that burden us down, weigh us down, and possibly would prevent us from experiencing all the joy that Papa's feast bring, and whatever the Ruach would like to bring us and teach us, and how, you know, to move us, what things would be standing in the way. So we practice Rafah. So we go out for, you know, 10, 20 minutes to hear the voice of Papa and to allow the Ruach to begin the process of extracting from us everything that this planet wants to tie us down to. So we want to let go of those things. So we write them down, and then everybody gives me their piece of paper. I don't read it, and we go down to the beach afterwards and we burn them. So the idea is that you let go. So maybe you're letting go of a sin or an addiction or something like that. You let it go, you write it down. It's not your job to get rid of it. It's Papa's job to get rid of it. Your job is to teshuvah, to turn, to say, I don't want that way anymore. I want to go your way, but I can't do it on my own. So here is my problem. Here is my issue. Here's my addiction. Here's my things that are possessing me right now. I give it to you to deal with. And his part is to actually tashlit it. And then together, you teshuvah. How cool is that? Together, you teshuvah. It's a process, one that takes a while, and the Ruach comes to help do that in you and to make you clean. Exercise on what if the king actually came tonight? How would you have prepared differently for the Feast of Trumpets had he come tonight? Yeah, so what do you have planned this week that if the king came back would interrupt? Would he interrupt some project you're in, or some movement you're having in your life or whatnot, or maybe a relationship is building? I don't know. For me, like, it's that was a pretty big question, because I'm working on a new website for our ministry. I'm working on a new book. I'm working on this and that, and I have all these projects for the king, and they're all good, except that if the king comes back, it may not happen anymore. So I need to be able to let go of that, because I don't want any strings to tie me down here. I don't want to be, you know, I told a story last night about when we lost everything, and I would explain to people, like, I felt like a hot air balloon with all this pressure, and you know, all the ropes that tie a hot air balloon down, and then they let the ropes go, and then the balloon flies. Well, I was feeling like Papa was cutting all the ropes to this hot air balloon, but there was that one on that basket. It was just, oh, it was so painful, and as soon as he cut that, then it was like, woo! Then we flew, and it was beautiful, but until that, it was very painful. So the idea that, you know, you don't want to go down with a Titanic, you don't want to be, you know, tied down to this planet when the planet goes, the idea of being a hot air balloon was, and cutting us free of the earth, was to set us free so that when the earth starts to go, you know, downhill, we won't. We'll actually, you know, be saved. So in honor of the seventh trumpet, which Yom Teruah is all about. Of course, I made seven hollows, and I meant to have seven baskets of light. But I did seven thoughts in honor of the seventh trumpet. Oh, and I gave out seven presents in honor of a Feast of Trumpets. But I had seven thoughts that Isaac and I came up with. One of them was biblical repentance. This is where the rubber meets the road. So keeping the rhythm of his feast days, of his Moedim, is where the rubber of repentance hits the road. So I know that Israel has itching ears, and they want to hear this new teaching and that new teaching and this new eschatology and this person's view on this and that, and they want a new calendar and all this stuff, you know. But in reality, none of that is, it's itching everyone's ears. It's not actually helping them repent, because repentance is all about a change in your whole entire life. It's going to affect you huge to repent of pagan holidays, and turn and embrace Papa's holidays. It's huge. That is going to take up most of your time. You're not going to have time to delve into things that are none of your business, none of my business. Things that are Papa's business, not our business. Our business is to repent. Our business is to Teshuvah. Our business is to operate as a priest directly to him, offer him our uniqueness, our creativity in his ways and doing his things. The Moedim is one way. There's loving each other, taking care of the poor and the widows and the orphans, setting apart your tithe to do what he tells you to do with it. All kinds of things like that is where the rubber meets the road. But Israel wants to sit in pews every week and have their ears itched with some new teaching. And it's frankly, it's just causing chaos and it's confusing everyone. So that is true biblical repentance. It's not just sitting in a pew getting your head filled with knowledge. That's a Greek mentality. The Hebrew mentality is to actually do it. It's a verb. You know, you live your life as a verb, basically, and you do. And one of the places that is most apparent in especially Western civilization, I think, is actually walking out these Moedim, along with taking care of the poor and the widows and the orphans and yada yada. So, Teshuvah Ministries wants to have a really clear voice, which is something about trumpets that's really cool. Trumpets is, if you watch Jim Staley's video and teaching on trumpets, it's really cool. There's a part in there where he talks about frequency and the idea that we're hammered silver. You know, gold is the king's metal, silver is next in line. We sit on the throne with Yeshua. It's amazing, but it's hammered silver. So there's two trumpets blown on two silver hammered trumpets blown on Yom Teruah, and they represent the house of Judah and the house of Ephraim, someday to be reunited together, to be one strong family again. But until then, they're two witnesses. But the hammered silver talks about the frequency of that trumpet. So when you blow a trumpet, it needs to have a really good, clear sound, because trumpets blown in the ancient days were used for all kinds of things, to call an assembly, to a coronation of a king, to call to battle, to danger, to beware, call to watch, all kinds of different things. And so that trumpet sound had to be very, very clear, or it was going to cause chaos throughout the community, which right now we're hearing a lot of things that are causing chaos among the people. Among people coming out of organized religion, realizing they're scattered Israel, what do we do? Oh my gosh, and you've got people who are standing up, talking heads, not teaching how to repent, but teaching a lot of philosophy, a lot of theology, a lot of head knowledge. But in reality, if that head knowledge doesn't turn into heart knowledge and you actually walk it out, it's nothing. It's not gonna do anything for you. So the word da'at is for head knowledge. The word yada is for heart knowledge. It's Isaac and my philosophy is, if the head knowledge, the da'at, doesn't move your heart into yada, into heart knowledge, shelve it until maybe the Ruach wants to bring it back and teach you something. But until then, it is not going to do anything for you except possibly keep you from actually repenting, which is part of what the call. It is the call, actually. The call is to repent, not to get head knowledge, but to repent and walk it out. Like, what frequency are you putting out? Is it chaos? Are you creating chaos? Are you actually putting out a frequency that is clear and helping people to find the way and get to the happily ever after, because that's the goal. The goal is happily ever after, is it not? The goal, the happily ever after, is the restoration of all things, not things made new. It's not going to be all new things. It's going to be a restoration of what he already made. So he made you to be a human being with flesh and blood. Yeshua has had flesh and blood. He's going to be flesh and blood forever. Why would we be made into something spirit that's floating around somewhere? No, the restoration of what the original idea was. Yehovah is going to restore everything to the original idea of creation, what he intended in the first place, which is man and woman, you know, being together and multiplying and having kids and getting to explore creation and the universe and being all you were created to be and getting to face-to-face relationship with Elohim themselves and ruling over the animals and over, not over each other, but over his creation that he gave us to rule over my garden. If I could do that, that would be good. So frequency is a really cool topic during trumpets, because it's all about, you know, the sound you're making. Is it clear? Is it making chaos? Be really careful of your frequency and being put through the knot holes, like the Cruz family and us the last couple, you know, weeks, probably 3 or 4 weeks, have been shoved through a knot hole to the point where you're exhausted and you think you're not going to come out alive. Part of the whole going through the knot hole is a refining process, and it hurts, and it's like something I've like struggled with and said, I don't want it. But when you go through the knot hole on the other side, as you come out of the knot hole, there's this, you know, pain gives movement kind of thing, and you get really, really clear with something. Like, I'm getting, after the pain I've just gone through, we're going to relaunch our website with really clear voice on certain things and what it means to repent and all this other stuff. A clear voice is what Yehovah is after, to give a clear sound, a clear frequency, a clear trumpet blast to the world, to the nations, to the friends we have, to tell them the king is coming back, and if you don't repent, you ain't going with them. One of the other things we talked about last night is holiday attachments. The idea that, John Eldridge talks about the heart, and he knows the heart so well. The heart will only trade up. It will never trade down. So if you've been raising your children in the pagan holidays with the tinsel and the glamour and the glit and all that stuff and the lights, and you expect them to turn with you to Papa's holidays and holy days, and yet they are full of, I don't know, plastic knives, paper plates, and potluck style, and no creativity, their heart isn't going to come over with you. Their heart's going to be back there attached to the pagan things. So what you want to do is you want to be creative with it and impress upon your children, like stamp, boom, like impress into their hearts Papa's ways. And so one of the only ways to help their hearts teshuvah is to offer them something better. And all I'm saying is that how you present his feast, how you present his moedim, is extremely crucial to being attached to them. You, your children and yourself have been attached to the pagan holidays for most of your life, and you want to help them reattach to Yehovah's better ways. I mean, they're just, the feasts are incredible. The moedim is amazing. They're full, they're deep, they're just, you can't ever fully explore them. And so offering your creativity, playing in the feast, is something that's so crucial to helping your children and your heart, you know, trade up. Your heart has a mind of its own. It's going to trade up. And if there's nothing better to trade up to, it's going to stay in the past. We looked at the fact that Yom Teruah is all about watching and knowing the season of his coming. We may not know the exact actual day, because we're waiting for that moon to appear. So there's some time of dark moon. So we don't know the day or the hour, but we do know the season. And those people who are walking in the light who are children of the light are going to know the appointed times. Which brings me back to the other idea. When Paul or Shaul was talking to people, he said, I don't need to talk to you about the Moedim, about the appointed times. You already know them. He wasn't challenging the calendar at that point. So the important thing is to find out what calendar were they on. Oh, we can look at and realize they were actually following the V, barley, and the sighted moon. So very simple. What was I on? What was I thinking? Yeshua told us in Luke that if anybody is preaching an imminent return, as in I can show up anytime, do not follow them and do not listen to them. Yom Teruah makes it very clear that this is an event that is going to happen, that is going to be worldwide, but we will know when it's going to happen. We can watch and see the times and know when it's going to happen. We might not know the day or the hour, but we'll know when it's going to happen. So don't listen to anybody who is preaching an imminent return, which I grew up with. So very hard to kind of wrap your brain around, but very crucial, because Yeshua said to not. So one of my other seven thoughts in honor of the seventh trumpet, it was, what did Yeshua preach during that time of year? Did you know that the chronological gospels, which details out the Messiah's, the events of his 70-week ministry, details out what he spoke about at each Moedim, and for most of the Moedim, and one of them for Yom Teruah, he actually 2 days before, I think it was 2 days before Yom Teruah, he gives a banquet. The feeding of the 5,000 was during that time. It was so cool. And, hey, I'm like my brother. I like to give a banquet. So we also see that the day before Yom Teruah, he preaches about resurrection, life, and belief. So one of the things that, of course, Trumpets is all about resurrection and life, but one of the things that was curious to us was belief, this belief thing. So Isaac has done a mind map study, which we'll make available on our website at some point, which is really cool when he studied into what belief means, because Yeshua said, you see, you must see and believe. So see and believe. These are two different things. See with our eyes, as in acknowledge that he's, you know, the people there were seeing him, but not believing. So what were they not believing? They were not believing in what? Well, his whole point was that they weren't believing that he was the prophet that Moses spoke about that would come, that we had to Shema, that we had to obey. So they weren't believing. It wasn't that they weren't believing that he didn't exist, because they saw him right there with their own eyes. But what they weren't believing was that he was the prophet that was spoken of that we must obey. And Yehovah put his words, the words that he spoke on the mountain during that first Melchizedek covenant, when he's making that contract with Israel. They said, no, don't talk to us anymore. Your words are scaring us. You're scary. So speak to Moses, and then we will do whatever Moses tells us. You tell us to do through Moses. And then at the end of that whole section there, and that before the covenant's confirmed, Yehovah says, fine, I'm going to give you a prophet someday and raise up from among you a brethren who I'm going to put my words in. The words I'm speaking right now on this mountain, I'm going to put in him, and he's going to speak them to you, and you must obey him. And if you don't obey him, bad news for you. You will be judged according to how you actually obey him, to your compliance to what he's saying. So he put his words in Yeshua, and Yeshua said, I didn't come to speak my own words. I came to speak the Father's words, right? So the idea of believe, it's not you believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and you shall be saved. It's not just up here. No, believe is a doing. It's actually a working out. Work out your faith. You work out your salvation. You actually have to do what Yeshua told you to do, which is exactly what Yehovah told us to do back then. The Melchizedek contract that is reestablished in the new contract, which we'll talk about again another day. But basically, you know, what I grew up with, believe in Jesus Christ and you shall be saved, that is not enough. That is not it. Believe that he exists. Yes, everyone. Lucifer. Hasatan believes that he exists. He sees him. He knows that he exists. He's been in conflict with him for like thousands of years. So that's nothing new, you know. The wicked know he exists, but the righteous are the ones that are going to believe that he is the prophet that would come, the son of Yehovah, who would speak the Father's words, and we must obey. And Yeshua said all the time, you want life? Keep the commandments. What commandments? The commandments that Yahweh spoke on the mountain. From Exodus 19 through 24, it's the royal law, the everlasting law that's always been and always will be, that we will all be judged by. So this is another thing that we talked about last night, Feast of Trumpets. So along with the idea of the imminent return, we talked about the idea that the fall feasts are unfulfilled. So we have the spring feast that he has already fulfilled. To the day and to the hour, he fulfilled those spring feasts, and the fall feasts have not been fulfilled. So the spring feasts were of a sacrificial nature. The fall feasts are of a political nature. He hasn't fulfilled those yet. And those people who say that they love the Messiah and can't wait for him to return, the second coming, they should be paying attention to these feasts, because I don't know about you guys, but when I grew up in the society I grew up with, in the religious society I grew up in, we chided the Jews for missing him the first time. Well, now we have a situation in our hands where Christians and a whole bunch of people who love Jesus and want to see him come back, or are desperate for him to come back, they themselves are going to miss the fall feast and how they're going to miss his return, because they're not paying attention to the fall feast, which will be fulfilled to the day and to the hour exactly, just like he did the first ones. So it's really important to figure out what these fall feasts are about and start walking in them and exploring the depths of them, so you can understand end time eschatology and be ready and watching for the return of the King, so that you can be lifting off the ground and not staying for the bowls of wrath that happen on the days of awe. You don't want to be here for that. So one of my other thoughts was the idea of talk is cheap. Talk is very cheap. So we have a little slogan to Teshuvah Ministries, which is, and the reason for that is you do have to learn something. So you do need some dot, because we've been fed so much bad dot. We have to like get some things straight and get some things cleared up and undo a bunch of things that we've inherited. So you do need some dot. You need to learn some stuff. So you learn it, but then you stop learning, in the sense of you stop inputting da'at, and then you live it. So you have to apply the knowledge, the head knowledge that you've learned, and walk it out and live it and learn some heart knowledge. Have the head knowledge transfer into heart knowledge. So then you actually walk it out. So you learn it, and then you live it, and you actually live it for a while. You live this process. You live repentance. You live out the covenant and the new contract. And then when you've lived it and you know it like the back of your hand and you are sure about it, so that your frequency is clear, then you tell it. This is the job of Melchizedek priest, a royal priest, is to tell it, but you're not supposed to tell it unless you actually live it and you know it for sure. Otherwise, you'll become a chaos creator. So you don't want to do that. You want to learn it, live it, then tell it. Something that I realized, that college is a self-feeding institution, because basically, like, I was an English major at one point, and you basically went through all that, paid all that money to get your degree, and basically my friends would just turn right around and get a job back in the college. No life experience, no out there among the, you know, the world learning this field to come back to give substance and meaning and substance and stuff for your students to chew on. No, you just turned right back around and taught, regurgitated everything you just knew or just learned in all your college days. So it's kind of similar to that. You don't just learn it and then tell it. You've got to learn it, live it, and then tell it. So I think that's a beautiful thing about the Hebrew walk, is it really, really encourages a verb sort of life, where you actually walk it out and learn it and then tell it. And your observance will become your teaching. So you won't have to just get up and yak and be a talking head. You actually, your observance, your repentance will become your teaching. And then the Ruach can work with that. The Ruach HaKodesh can work with that. So one thing I wanted to add to the talk is cheap, live, learn, tell idea. When you are searching for a calendar, there's really only three main ones, but when you're searching for a calendar, there's a lot of chaos making going on out there. Look in the scriptures and decide. What is it that you want to follow? And then follow it and do it, commit it, commit to it, work it out, actually live in it. And I think it will teach you whether it is doable or not. So the Aviv barley-sided moon for us, we have lived it for a very long time. And I know others who have lived it for a long time. It is doable. It is workable. It is something you don't need a computer for. Live it out. Actually commit to it. Being in a non-committal state is not beautiful. It's not good. I don't think Papa asked us to live in that state. He wants to see you commit, get off the fence, either you're hot or you're cold kind of thing. I wish you were one or the other. So figure it out, what you want to learn, and then walk it out, live it, and see whether it works or not. And it will teach you. Your observance of the fall feast during this time is really no small thing. It's a very epic thing you're doing. The whole universe sees and watches, and it's extremely epic. As I was out shopping for the feast and different items that I needed this week, of course I'm not rich, so I'm like scrounging through some secondhand stores, and man, it didn't matter whether it was secondhand stores or big department stores or wherever, grocery stores, it didn't matter. The pagan holidays are upon us, and it's awful. And I felt like afterwards I needed a mikvah purification because I was traveling I'd leave the girls in this car and I would go in and get what I needed. I was very focused on what I needed, but I was like, all this stuff is around me. It felt like it wanted me. And, it's like this little light kind of traveling through all this darkness. And for you to stand up in the middle of the stream and turn around and walk the other day, it's no small matter. It's extremely epic. And Yeshua, his reward will come with him. He promises his reward will come with him. So this will cost you. Walking in repentance costs you. I will not offer the king when I celebrate one of his Moedim. I will never offer him something that does not cost me. So I spend a lot of time and energy and money and thought and creativity on things. I offer him my heart. I offer him everything. I will not offer him something that costs me nothing. So I just want you to know that celebrating his ways in the middle of all this pagan nonsense is extremely epic. It's extremely epic. I was in one store this week, and I was standing in line, and I was in Joann Fabrics, actually, and a little teenage couple had been in there getting their costume for the upcoming evil day of Halloween, and I met up with them in line, and they were in front of me, and the girl was kind of giddy about it, and I knew what they were talking about. She goes, "I can't wait for the spirit to come." And my heart was just like, I just sank. I just couldn't believe that this kid, this teenage, wet behind the ears kid, could be calling upon the evil kingdom to come. And so here goes my other teaching is that you need to be very specific about what ruach you're talking about, what spirit you're talking about, and what spirit you want to come. It was very clear what spirit she wanted to come because of what they were purchasing and how they were talking. But I am very clear on what spirit I want to come. I want the Ruach HaKodesh to come and fill me up and live in me and speak through me and cleanse me from all walking through all this pagan stuff. So just remember, it's not a small thing that you're celebrating, that you're setting apart these Moedim, that you're stopping work, that you're stopping school, that you're setting apart. We had a teenager here last night who actually called into work and said, "I'm not coming today because it is Yom Teruah and I'm going to a banquet." Isn't that cool? Oh, it's very cool and hard. It will cost him something. He has a little bit of backlash, I'm sure. It could cost him his job. Who knows? But the idea that you show up, epic, epic, epic. Feast of Trumpets is all about superhero Yeshua. Okay, so my daughter loves superheroes, the Avengers and all this stuff. And I think at the heart of those movies is this collective need for rescue. I mean, this planet is burning up fast. It's going, everything, the fear is running out of control, chaos making, just, all this stuff. It's too much for one heart to bear. You don't turn on the news because it's too much for your heart. It will crowd out room for the Ruach to move, the Ruach HaKodesh to move, and it will crowd out Papa, if you watch too much of it. But just know, it's a mess. Everybody knows it's a mess. And so everybody's longing for rescue, longing for somebody to sweep in and make something bad right. And so here you have an opportunity with Yom Teruah to actually be excited about the true superhero that is going to come fly in and rescue us. without CGI, without some stupid costume that's too tight. Oh yes, no CGI in this next move of Yeshua's. When Yeshua comes, no, there's no green screen. No, no. It's going to be for real, people. Get out of the computer. Get out of your head. Get out of the TV. Get out of the movies. Take that desire you have. Place it on Yeshua. And fall to your knees and repent. And get ready to go home. And if you don't repent, you ain't going. That is so not going to be good. You want to go, trust me. So just one closing thought on the Feast of Trumpets is that this is a crazy time to be throwing a feast. I mean, just look at everything going on in the world, and here we are sitting throwing a feast. Feast for the eyes and for the heart and for the stomach and for the soul and for the mind. It's a feast all around. That's how when I create a feast, it's got to be a feast all the way around, so that you come away from it filled up from the bottom of your toes to the top of your head. It's a very difficult time to be throwing a feast. The world is in chaos. It's like the middle of war. That's one of the reasons I love the story of Purim and the story of Queen Esther. When her life was on the line, when her lives of her people were at stake, what does she do? She's on her face for 3 days and three nights fasting with all of Israel, and she gets up off the floor basically with the idea, I'm going to throw a feast. I'm going to woo the king. And I'm going to reel him in with a feast. And I just am blown away at her courage, at her bravery, at how her and the Ruach did that. And she was open to that idea. I don't know if I would have had the presence of mind to do that, but she did. And right now, we're in the same sort of situation, you know, in the sense of our lives are on the line. Our, you know, everything around us is disaster and getting worse by the minute, and yet we are supposed to stop and celebrate his ways. We were supposed to stop and throw a feast. So it's no small thing to throw a feast in the middle of a war. But one of the other cool things about Feast of Trumpets is the High Shabbat, and one of the things we talked about last night was a Shabbat. Shabbat is a day of rest. It's not just one in seven, it's a specific day in seven. It's Saturday, it's Friday evening to Saturday evening, it's Erev Shabbat to the end of Shabbat. And that day is actually not a day of rest in trade for work accomplished or work finished. It's actually a day of rest required of us in the middle of being unfinished. It's walking into royalties, walking to our royal heritage to say, we are not slaves to Egypt anymore. I'm not a slave to my job. I'm not a slave to this, this, and this. That actually I can stop. I will stop because the king requires it of me, and I will set it apart and rest according to the commandment in the middle of work not done, in the middle of kind of, you know, chaos in the world. We're stopping to party. We're going to pop the cork and party in the middle of things undone and things not finished. King comes back. I'm excited for that day. Oh my gosh. Can you imagine the great wedding feast? He's going to pop the cork, people. We're going to actually like be physical bodies. We're going to like watch him pop the cork, and we are going to scream and shout. Oh, which one of the things we do at Feast of Trumpets, Teruah is the word shout, basically. Shout, make a loud noise, yada yada. So we go down to the beach afterwards. Last night we went down to the beach and lit sky lanterns as an offering of fire and water lanterns as an offering of fire. And burned a refah list and stuff. And we had a group hug and a group prayer. Oh, it was so beautiful. I just loved hearing everybody's just heart. They just wanted to pray so bad. They wanted to speak it. They wanted to speak and give thanks and glory to the King and to Yehovah for all he has done and the rock. And then afterwards we sang a song together while we're there in the group. And then we shouted to Yeshua. And basically we all shouted and we all say, come get us, Yeshua. How cool is that? Wow. want you to experience what repentance is all about. And repentance doesn't have to look like ashes and sackcloth. There's a time for that, and I've done it, but there's a time for everything, is there not? And so we want to, I know Wendy and I were talking last night, another feast diva, that I want to say, you know, we wanted to say, you know, if we make it so beautiful, and we can't understand why anybody just wouldn't want to come to these things and to celebrate his Moedim, because we think they're so romantic, and Papa is so into romance. You know how he does. You know, he is basically betting everything on the fact that him romancing us back into a relationship with him, romancing us back into repentance and into this walk, is stronger than anything Hasatan can throw us. So any addiction, any kind of bait that Hasatan has for us, Yahweh is counting on. He knows us so well. He knows that this is true, that romance will strike at the heart. Romance and get you to fall in love with him, with Elohim, with the three of them. Oh, if you fall in love, you're unstoppable. Because isn't a woman who's in love unstoppable? You know, I mean, she's going to put up with a lot of stuff from her guy, and he doesn't have to be a good guy. She'll put up with a lot of stuff when she's in love. I've done it. I've been there. Abused woman, you know, not anymore. But been there, done that. I know what it's like to be so head over heels in love that you'll do anything. So he's banking on the fact that that Elohim themselves are so beautiful, so incredible, that you will fall in love with them and want to do things their way, to want to obey, to want to get into that contract so that you can have they can have your signature on that dotted line. So when Hasatan comes to claim you, they can reach into their file cabinet and find that piece of paper where you have signed on the dotted line, and it releases you from the claim of Hasatan. That's what you want. Everything's done legally in the heavens. Nothing is done illegal. Papa doesn't do anything illegal. Hasatan will not allow him to do anything illegal. So everything is done legally. Your engagement ring is the Shabbats. You keep the Shabbats as a sign that you are in covenant with Yahweh in the new covenant. Well, there's so much there to unpack with the contracts. You have the first contract that he made with Israel, then you have the second contract, so the new covenant, the new Melchizedek covenant and contract. We'll talk about that more. It's a huge thing and something that is beautiful. But for now, remember, he's all about getting you to fall in love with him. I hope you do. I hope you want to follow his ways and keep his Moedim and repent and turn and join us for the feast again. We have Yom Kippur coming up. We have Sukkot after that. And then, of course, Hanukkah and Purim and all the rest of the spring feast. Beautiful things, beautiful things. So I want to teach you how to repent through my family's repentance. This is how we repent, and I am building an archive online for my own daughters to access as they grow older, them and their families, to say, oh, what did mom and dad believe? Oh yeah. And they can go to the website and they can see. So I'm putting it out there for everyone to partake in so that you can learn from my observance, from my obedience, my repentance, and then walk it out yourself. In your own creativity, in your own way, walk it out yourself. Definitely want you to come to our feast table. We definitely want to build a community. I don't want you to come and then disappear by any means. No, I want to support each other and encourage each other and build a community of healthy, strong people who are clear about what the mission is and what we're supposed to be doing with our life and how to repent. And so that we make a movement. But in the end, like we talked about last night, it is the Ruach's job to move on everybody's heart. All we can do is live out and walk out our repentance, and then the Ruach will send people into our path to just light up their way and show them how. In the end, no matter how many invitations I send out, no matter how many RSVP cards with stamps on them that I send out trying to get people to respond to me to come to the feast, you know, it's not about what I do, and I have to remember that. Like, I go to a lot of work for this, but at the same time, that's my offering to Papa. This whole thing I'm placing on, last night I placed it on the altar on Papa's altar, and I give it to him to use as he wishes. So he could burn it up. He could blow it away with a windstorm, which has almost happened on the top of the parking garage at Boise State when I was president of the Hebrew Roots Club. We had Yom Teruah up there and had wine glasses. I had this table sitting up there. And a huge windy night, really stormy night, which was really cool because Yom Teruah someday will be a very stormy, windy, you know, crazy night, and it's not going to be a peaceful setting like this. It's going to be very wild. And so we were experiencing that, and wine glasses were tipping over and breaking and stuff, and everybody was worried about how I was feeling. But in all reality, it was an offering that I gave him, and he can bring a windstorm and blow it all away if he wants to. It's his problem. So I have to let go, and I have to say the Ruach HaKodesh, you know, is the one moving on people's hearts. And so I think you're called, and I think the Ruach is taking blinders off people's eyes, who they want to take blinders off people's eyes. I do believe that people get to choose, in the sense we all have free will. So you're choosing, absolutely, but you've been choosing your whole life. And they know kind of how the process of your life has been when truth has been presented. Have you received it? Have you not? Have you shut it out? Have you not? Have you wanted to walk in it? Have you not? So I know that in the end we will be solidified, and which is happening right now. We are being solidified right now in what our heart's desire is. Just like Pharaoh, you know, Yehovah didn't harden his heart. He hardened what Pharaoh already wanted, like cement grows hard, you know. Pharaoh was like this. He didn't like Papa, he hated Papa, whatever. So Yahweh just hardened, made that cement in his heart hard, so that he was no longer one way or the other. He was one way. And he used it, Yahweh used it to his advantage. So the same thing's happening now. You either, you know, are for him or you're against him, and he's gonna give you what your heart desires. And frankly, you know, for me, I am so for him that I can't stop. I literally am obsessed. I get up in the morning, I think about his things, his kingdom ways. I meditate on his law day and night, just like King David did. And the more and more the closer I get to the king's return, the more focused I get, the more obsessed I get over him and getting to see him and have his eyes on me. I get to see his eyes, his hug. The full physical, visual feel of that moment is going to be overwhelming. It's going to be a move that bus sort of moment, you know. So I'm excited about that, and I hope you are too. I hope that my excitement kind of stirs your heart as well. In conclusion, I wanted to make sure that everybody understands that the fall feasts tell us what is going to happen at the end of the age. That we're supposed to pay attention, we're supposed to be watching. But what exactly are we supposed to be watching? Are we supposed to be watching the media and the media's take on the events, or man and what man says? Are we supposed to be watching what Hasatan is doing? No, we are supposed to be watching what Yehovah is doing and what he is up to. And the best way to do that is literally to take part in these fall feasts and the fall Moedim, and discover the depth and the layers of them. And in those layers and in those depths, you will discover the what is going to happen at the end of the age. We're not going to know everything perfectly. We're human. We're mortal. The one that knows everything is Yehovah. And but the one thing we do know how to do perfectly, and is we do know how to repent. We know how to repent. Repentance, walking that out, will make us perfect like Yeshua, ready to ascend with him on that day. But something to just consider, you know, get ready for this day. Be ready for the Feast of Trumpets. Even if you don't know the rest of the story, what's going to happen after that, be ready for the Feast of Trumpets, because that's the day he's going to come. And then let your bridegroom take you on a journey during that fall feast season to watch as he fulfills the rest of the fall feast. Just take the arm of your bridegroom and walk away from this planet as it is right now, and let him take you on this beautiful ride into the fall feast season, the Moedim's being fulfilled right in front of your eyes, and let him put you on your white horse, and you're going to follow him back to earth and watch him take it. Hopefully this helped just a little bit to introduce you to Yom Teruah and the beautiful feast that this is, this beautiful Moedim. And gave you some stuff to chew on, to think about, and explore. Shalom. I'm going to clean up tomorrow. Today, we rest. Beach was so fun, trying to light those lanterns and offering a fire to Papa on the water and in the air. If anything, we learned you can't really do it with a lot of wind, but it was so fun.